You're listening to The Money Hour with your host, Tina Mitchell, and co-host, Keelan Harvey on Alternative Talk AM 1150. Now, back to the show with local mortgage experts, Tina Mitchell and Keelan Harvey.
You are listening to The Money Hour on 1150 AM KKNW, the Saturday, April 17th show. You can also listen to our show on podcast or Facebook premiere show. I am your host, Tina Mitchell.
And I'm your co-host, Keelan Harvey.
We bring into studio each week the best of the best experts in our local market when it comes to your money. We are here to help you in today's economy. And now in studio, Dan Gallahay on everything that you wanted to know about homeowners insurance, but were too afraid to ask, right here on 1150 AM KKNW. Dan, excited to have you on the show.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you.
So Dan, before we jump into today's topic, tell me a bit about your agency and what other types of insurance do you offer?
So we are a longstanding, independent personal lines agency on the east side. So personal lines insurance of all sorts. What does that mean? That means auto, home, rental properties, renter's insurance, earthquake, flood, and then all the toys, boats, motorcycles, RVs. All things personal lines. And, you know, I'm really big on education. Insurance policies are contracts, and a lot of customers see them as overly complicated by legalese that kind of helps insurers avoid pay claims. So I feel like part of my job is to help clients fully understand important parts of their policies. And that way they can make more informed decisions about what coverages to purchase and the reasons behind it, as well as some mitigation steps that they may take on their own.
Well, and Dan has stepped in and helped out homeowners that I've had that have ran into issues with their insurance company, one of the big carriers, because it's one carrier. And so working with somebody that has access to multiple carriers that can step in, not only finding you a competitive in the price end of it, but making sure that you're getting the best coverage and coverage that might be a little bit unique based on your current financial situation. So Dan, when you look at the dwelling coverage amount on your homeowner's policy, it's clearly a different amount than what your home is worth. Now, I know about this because I'm in the mortgage industry, but can you share with our listeners why that is?
I can, and that's a common misconception because a lot of times people will look at that number and go, well, that's not how much my house is worth. Am I insured for the right amount? And so replacement cost is often confused with market value, but when it comes to calculating the rebuilding cost of a home, for insurance purposes, the only considerations are the cost of building material and labor. So land value and market conditions never play a part in that number. And in a region like where we live in Puget Sound, where home values are very high, the difference between those two numbers can be much greater. So if you imagine a 2,500 square foot house in Seattle, for example, and the cost to rebuild completely may be $500,000, but the sale price may hit $1 million or $1.1 million. So insurance is really focused on the replacement of the house, and that's it. But that being said, it's really important to be insured to at least 100% of that rebuilding cost estimate to avoid underinsurance and to avoid any issues in the event of a substantial loss.
And shout out there, Dan, that's why it's so important to have an expert like you that you need to talk to, because I have this kind of disclosure talk with my customers. You need to make sure that your insurance is on point. You don't want to underpay, you don't want to overpay. You want to make sure you have that sweet spot to make sure that you don't have any issues if something happens. And speaking of, if something happens, how big of an issue could you explain is being underinsured, and or what happens if you have a loss?
Yeah, great question. So nationally, I can tell you it's a very large and chronic problem. And I see it a lot when I'm reviewing a potential client's home insurance with their current carrier. And I'll give you an example. The San Diego wildfires, if you remember from 2003 and 2007, really kind of highlight this issue of underinsurance. So the California Department of Insurance reported in a typical year, they receive about 1% frequency rate of complaints for auto claims. In other words, they receive about one complaint per 100 auto claims. But in contrast to that, the complaint ratios for homeowner losses arising from those fires were more than 20%. And there were a lot of homeowner complaints that came out of the Colorado wildfires in 2012 along those same lines. And a lot of these complaints dealt with the same issue, and that issue is under insurance, particularly for higher value homes. And according to one of the largest residential building cost data companies, Marshall and Swift, they're saying about 60 to 65% of all U.S. homes are undervalued by an average of 19%.
Wow.
And that's a huge number and a huge problem. And if you think about, you know, let's say a home, the average cost of a replacement cost for a home is $400,000. It may be insured for only $324,000, which is a shortfall of $76,000. So that's potentially a huge coverage gap. You know, if the home's not insured with a guaranteed replacement cost or extended replacement cost provision. And on top of that, the fact that construction costs often surge following large regional catastrophes can exacerbate this problem. And kind of one more point to make on that is with total losses, underinsurance is made worse by building codes and ordinance requirements that change year after year. So for example, a lot of communities across the nation have passed tough electrical codes during the past few years, and that can add anywhere from 10 to 15% to the cost of rebuilding a home.
Wow. Well, I can say, speaking from experience on a good side, thank goodness we were not underinsured when my husband caught our kitchen on fire and we lived in a hotel for almost a year. So we were covered, thank goodness. So Deanne, what can you do to combat this issue?
There's a few things consumers could do. They should first review their policies to see if they have protective measures built in. And what I mean by that is they want to look for verbiage for things like guaranteed replacement cost coverage, which means that the insurance company will rebuild the home with light material and quality on an uncapped basis, but if and only if they're insured to value to begin with. A lot of policies offer extended replacement cost coverage, which offers basically a buffer. So it will cover a home up to, say, 125 or 150% of whatever they're insured for. And then a lot of carriers also offer inflation guard protection that automatically increases the dwelling coverage every year to keep pace with the rising costs of building material and labor. And then lastly, one of the best things that a consumer can do is if you've not had your policy reviewed for several years, call your agent, have them complete a new cost estimator on your home to make sure that you are still covered adequately, because that number can change dramatically over the years.
Inflation. I didn't think about that one, Dan. That's super smart, you know, and especially now because inflation is increasing as we speak right now. So here in Seattle for years and years, we hear talk of the big one. And of course, we're referring to the earthquake, you know, that they've been talking about for 30 years now, knock on wood or anything else, glass, whatever you believe in. Is earthquakes covered and by your home insurance policy?
That is a great question, Keelan. And the answer to that is no. So in a standard homeowner policy, earthquake damage is not covered. There are a few carriers out there that offer up a rider that you can add to your homeowner policy, but really a better way to go is to look at a specialty company that exclusively writes earthquake policies if you're looking to cover that risk and get protected that way.
Yeah, and Dan, talking about additional coverage in the lending side, there's what's called a flood cert part of your closing cost, very small fee. However, a lot of times people go, well, I'm not located in a flood zone. Understood, but you still have to have that flood cert. And if you are located in a flood zone, the lender's going to require insurance. So can you talk about that? And because it's not part of your standard homeowner's policy.
That's correct, Tina. So flood damage by flood is not covered under a standard homeowner policy, just like earthquake. It would be a separate policy. And your lender typically would let you know if you're living in a floodplain. But even if you're not living in a floodplain and it's not required, if consumers want to protect themselves from that risk, they have the opportunity to buy a flood policy.
And what about damage caused by wear and tear? Obviously, living in a home, you can kind of beat it up as time goes on. Do they cover anything like that?
Typically not, no. So the purpose of insurance is to cover an unexpected and sudden loss. So things that degrade over a long period of time are generally considered more of a maintenance issue and one of the responsibilities of a homeowner to keep up on those items.
So Dan, had a few questions here left to ask, but we're wrapping up the show. So I'd want to just allow you the opportunity to give the last tip and advice that you have on homeowners insurance.
You know, one of the big questions I get is, gosh, how do I lower my insurance premiums and do I need to reduce coverages to do that? And typically lowering coverages is the last resort. And it's really the last thing you want to do. There's a number of things that homeowners can do to reduce cost. And one of the biggest things is increasing your deductible. So if you think about it, a lot of carriers will offer pretty substantial discounts by moving your deductible from, say, $1,000 to $2,500. And it makes sense for a lot of people because typically if a homeowner has a loss of, say, $2,000, they're not going to file the claim anyway. So why not take advantage of those savings and just go with a higher deductible?
Well, Dan, thank you so much for joining us on the show. Very excited for our listeners to get the wealth of information that you have and encourage our listeners, reach out to the show if you want to connect with either one of our guests. Again, we bring in the best of the best so we can get you connected with the best of the best. Dan, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.